Are you troubled by expensive credit card charges for movie-inspired props?
Do you experience feelings of dread in your wallet or savings account?
Have you or anyone in your family experienced fear of missing out when it comes to adult collectibles?
If the answer is yes, then don't wait another minute. Pick up the phone and get in touch with the professionals. Haslab!
Hello? Just kidding. Haslab doesn't have a landline, and our courteous and efficient staff is not on call 24 hours a day to serve all of your supernatural, elimination, adult collectible needs. Haslab.
I'm a designer here on Ghostbusters at Hasbro. And with me today, I have Eric Reich, who's a co-producer, and Jason Reitman, who's a co-writer and director of the new Ghostbusters Afterlife film.
Hey, Bill.
How you doing?
How's it going? I'm doing good.
Jason, our first question is for you. What was it like seeing the Proton Pack on set for the first time?
An absolute thrill. And you have to remember that when I was 6 years old, I was actually on the set of the original film in 1984. So to see our Proton Pack, you know, 35 years later on set, it's the moment you realize, wait a second, I think we're making a Ghostbusters movie.
Did your dad, Ivan, let you try it on when you were 6 years old?
I think it would have been too heavy. I think I would have fallen over. But he did bring home a Neutrona wand, and I made the awful mistake of just, like, playing with it like a toy as a kid, so I just thrashed this piece of movie history.
Were you allowed to keep it after that?
I still have it. I may have to bring it out here to Pawtucket so you guys can maybe, like, bring it back to life.
I'll fix it for you.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
We have some great
Can you put new features in it? Can you make it, like, buzz and, like, give noises and lights and stuff?
Absolutely. Do that. We can do anything here at Hasbro. All right. Eric, when did you first see the Proton Pack?
During pre-production, we actually brought in a fan to look at one of the original Proton Packs, sort of to get inspiration for this new one. And I remember seeing the actual prop, I believe at the prop warehouse when we first started looking at the packs, the shells of the pack. And that day was really special because Violet Ramis was there and she actually got to try on Egon's original
her father's pack.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So that was the first time I saw it.
So it's been updated. What was the inspiration for updating the Proton Pack?
You know, we wanted to show years of ghostbusting on that pack. So it's almost more just the wear and tear. It's the scratches, it's the nicks. You know, we replaced the handle on it. And we wanted to be able to see inside it for the first time.
Speaking of inside, we get to see inside the cyclotron for the first time. What was the inspiration for that design?
You know, that was one of those thrilling moments where we have, you know, these film designers who are working with a piece of iconography that kind of anyone knows who's ever watched a Ghostbusters movie. And it was really up to them, you know, and they obviously researched the science. I don't think they visited CERN or anything, but they really tried to think about, okay, how would have Egon built this thing? And what could it possibly look inside? And that's one of those moments as collective filmmakers that you get to have a lot of fun.
That's great. I hear there's a funny backstory on some of the switches involved in the actual prop itself. Is there anything you can share?
I'll say this. There's a moment, if you're a Ghostbusters fan, that you definitely know, in which the Ghostbusters arrive at their first call at a hotel in New York City. They're in the elevator, and Dan reaches over to flip on the switch on Egon's back. And you hear the thing boom up, and they obviously, you know, they take a step back. Yeah. And we always thought, where's that switch? What does that switch look like? Yeah. And it became a goal of ours to actually show the switch for the first time. So it was the biggest change to the pack is we actually located and created the switch.
I remember actually looking at the film, and we were looking at the pack and saying, is it under here? Is it over here?
Exactly.
And we figured out the exact spot for it. So,
which, you know, it's a lot of responsibility. When you take a piece of iconography from a famous movie, you know, it's like talking about a lightsaber or the DeLorean, you know? Mm-hmm. Everyone knows exactly what it looks like. And if you're going to add something, it better be right.
Absolutely. Do you have any other funny stories about the Proton Pack maybe on set at all?
I remember my friend Anthony Bresnigan, who's a journalist, came to set one day, and Bill Murray was there. And Bill was telling Anthony, all right, you want to know what it's like to be a Ghostbuster? Why don't you wear this for an hour without taking a break? Put him on a stopwatch.
And Anthony put on. He actually did it.
Oh, yeah, he did it. But by the end of the hour, his back was in pain.
Ouch.
Yeah. And he was saying even the original one was heavier than what the kids got. So yeah. He was giving Ivan a hard time for that one.
All right. So we know for the Neutrona one, there was a light built in the prop for filming purposes. Mm. Are there any notable things that were added to the Proton Pack for the same purpose of filming?
It's a great question. It's interesting. You know, my cinematographer, Eric Steelberg, and I were watching the original. We watched it, I don't know, a billion times. The only person who's watched the movie more, I think, is Eric. And we were looking at the wand, and Eric noticed this little light on the top that clearly was not there as part of the prop, except to light the actors' faces. And you can start to notice it when you watch the original. When they're holding the wand, there's a little light, and it's there just to give them a little up light while they're shooting. So we wanted to make sure we included that.
Oh, that's great. All right, I got some rapid-fire questions.
Okay.
All right. Eric, we got a question for you. How did you get involved with Ghostbusters?
So I've always been a fan of Ghostbusters my entire life, and I can remember playing with the Kenner toys when I was younger. And in 2015, I was working with Ivan Reitman, and this opportunity came up with Ghost Corps, and I was super excited to take on that responsibility and join in with Ivan to live out my childhood dreams of becoming a Ghostbuster. And I actually, my nephew and niece, they call me a Ghostbuster. They think I work for the Ghostbusters, which is the best part.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's great. Jason, first thought when you saw our HasLab project?
Couldn't believe it, honestly. When I walked in here and I took a look at it, I thought the real pack was here. And I'm not just trying to be nice. It's extraordinary. The wear, the tear, the look, it has that.
Oh, stop. No, keep going. Fair enough.
It really was. And look, when I was 7 years old in 1984, every kid I knew was a Ghostbuster that Halloween. But no one had anything that looks like that. That is an absolutely extraordinary toy. I can't believe you get to bring it home.
Oh, thanks. No, there's a huge team involved in the development of it, and we're super excited to be working with everyone, and we're excited for fans to get their hands on it, too.
I couldn't believe that you could actually open it up and see inside, see the cyclotron exactly the way we showed it in the movie. And also, I just love that there's cables to unhook, screws to twist off. I mean, it's the kind of stuff that makes things feel real.
Yeah, it makes you feel like a Ghostbuster. You're actually in the item. It's great.
Yeah.
We're excited. Eric. Which Ghostbuster do you feel like that you are most like and why?
That's a tough one. I'd want to say Egon, but I'm not a math and science guy. So I feel like Ray would probably be a good sort of middleman. He's good at tinkering with things and figuring problems out. And
he is the heart and the passion and kind of the keeper of Ghostbusters.
Right?
And I think that's exactly who you are.
That's great. That's good. All right, Jason, back to you. First thought that comes to your mind with Mini Puffs.
Chaos. Demonic toddler chaos. You know, when Gil Kenan and I came up with the idea for the Mini Puffs, the whole thought was, you know, what if we just had these little ghosts that were like five-year-olds that wanted to break everything? And at that point, everywhere we went, we just imagined the Mini Puffs destroying things.
That's fantastic. Yeah, they're adorable little monsters for sure. Mm. It's great. All right, Eric, back to you. One word that describes what it is like working with Hasbro. You can be honest.
One word. amazing.
That's it.
Yeah, it's been a fantastic partnership. I think working with you guys has actually been really fun for me because I've been working on movies for a while, but to actually work on something outside of a movie and see the ideas that, you know, Jason and Gil have brought to life in the movie also come to life on toy shelves has been really fun.
It's been fun for us also. I mean, yeah. You've been an amazing partner back. I mean, great brand and great partnership. Last question.
For a more confounding adjective. I think you should have gone with like yellow.
Yeah.
Yellow.
German.
Haslab.
Haslab. All right, last question, Jason, for you. Can you describe the feeling you had when you first saw your movie all put together on film for the first time? Finally complete, done.
You know, a couple nights ago, I was in New York City for Comic-Con, where we watched the film for the first time with 3,000 fans, and I was sitting next to my father, which really made the whole thing extraordinary. And something kind of occurred to me. I'd experienced something like that before, and it was like being at Sundance. It's just people who love movies. And to watch Ghostbusters Afterlife with people who love it, who felt like it was Christmas morning, they were opening up gifts one after the other, I'm not sure what'll ever top it.
All right, well, I want to take the opportunity to thank you guys both for taking the time out of your schedules to come over to Pawtucket, Rhode Island, and meet with us for a little bit and talk a little Haslab.
Absolutely. Look, I mean, who of us did not grow up playing with Hasbro toys? The idea that we've just made a movie that has Hasbro toys is insane. It's, you know, film has become so virtual, you know? Our film exists in the digital space. The idea that we can actually pick up a toy, it makes it all real.
That's what it's all about.
It's been a lot of fun. Thank you for having us.
Oh, absolutely. Yep. Thank you, guys.